Greetings from Czech Republic. My name is Lukáš Podpěra and I'm a 7-dan player. For today I chose the topic of 3-3 invasion because it became very, very popular recently, especially thanks to the AI. So we will explore it together today. First, we have to go back to the history of thinking about the star point. In the Shusaku era in the 19th century, star point was not appearing very often in the professional games because the corner seemed to be too open. The star point is not securing the corner yet, and if we would just follow this basic joseki, which we all know, this was considered to be a good result for white already. Okay, which sounds a bit unbelievable to nowadays thinking, but at that time this was the thinking of the top professional players. If you would take a look on the book Invincible, which consists of many Shusaku's games, then you would see star point very rarely. And in case white approaches, then black immediately takes the corner like this, almost no matter what situation it is. Therefore, you can see what taking the corner meant to the professionals in that era. Then later on, especially in Gosaigen's era, in the mid of 20th century, this was reconsidered. This joseki which we have just followed started to be considered to be good for black. However, this joseki is often used in case black has a stone here and here, for example. Then the sansan is still open, and if white would invade somewhere else, then white can get under attack. Like this, white can get just a secured corner, and white is fine. So in case black has like a two-wing formation from the star point, then definitely sansan invasion is an option. However, on an empty board, it was still very rare to see it in the actual games. However, with the arrival of AlphaGo and the other AIs, then most of the AIs started to prefer to play the sansan invasion right away, already at the beginning of the game. However, this result is still very unacceptable for white. So what's wrong here? What's the main point of the problem is this exchange. This exchange, this Hane and connection for black's block and hanging connection, is a very big profit for black. So, what happens if white tanukis directly? Is white is directly alive in the corner. If white plays somewhere else, then black cannot kill white anymore. However, black can get both of these moves in center. In case white would tanuki right now, then black can set up a killing sequence like this, which is also very, very well known, and it's good to remember it if we just finish the sequence like this. So white is dead, and of course white cannot accept such a result. Black spent quite a lot of moves in the corner, but still white cannot just die like this. So giving black these two moves is quite a big value for black, so white has to answer, and white doesn't want to finish like this in the corner. Which means white has to find a way how black will not have these center moves from the outside. So we have already concluded that Q18 and R18 are minuses for white. But what if white pushes once more? If white pushes once more, then actually black doesn't have those center moves anymore. Black keeps this descent as center, but this is not a center anymore. So this move doesn't have so big value. It can be considered as endgame. And if we compare this exchange, I will mark it like this, with the exchange I have showed at the beginning, then definitely this one is a way smaller damage for white than the one I showed before. So if white actually plays this exchange and then switches somewhere else, then actually this result is considered as a fine one for white. which is a very big change compared to before. Also, the problem for Black is that also actually a very big change of thinking after the arrival of AI, that this wall is not always actually a strong influence. If White gets some stones somewhere around, like for example, if White plays here and then later gets a stone here, then in case White will get another next move, then White can play this peep, and actually Black's wall is not an influence anymore, and it can be actually quite a heavy group. Especially the peep at P15 is very annoying. Which means that actually this result itself is considered to be slightly good for White. Which if you would say this to the professionals back to like 50 years ago, I think they would not believe. However, this is the reality, and since this result is not satisfactory enough for Black in most of the situations, then Black started to search for another ways how to handle the 3-3 point invasion, which we will explore together. This Hane is actually still possible, but just in case Black will not extend like this, but Black will play here. And if Black plays this double Hane, which is also a basic joseki, then White just follows the basic variation like this, and it's kind of a compromise. However, it's good to mention that actually this ponuki is quite powerful. White can now switch somewhere else, so White spares one move in this corner, Black spent one move more, and White can hardly get under attack with this ponuki. However, going up here still is quite valuable, so White very often plays here directly. Also, what is good to remember, that for Black it's good to play the double Hane at S14, just in case Black has a corner in the bottom right. If the ponuki would face White's corner, then this result is definitely favorable for White. White gets two nice influence from the ponuki. Okay, even though the corner gives quite a nice profit, still White is definitely not unhappy. Even if there is a Black's corner in the bottom right. However, there are many professional players, like for example Kejie, who is actually choosing this joseki as Black very often. But again, as I have said, just in case he has his own corner here. Maybe some of you have already seen that White also sometimes tries to switch to the other side. By cutting here. However, this result is not really good for White. White gets actually a nice ponuki again, but White doesn't have any forcing moves on Black's corner. If White plays, for example, here, or if White goes up here, then Black doesn't mind. There is no threat on Black, so this result is definitely better for Black than the previous one. So that's almost the only option where Black can choose this Hane. So Black has to think about some other options, and there are usually two options which come to mind, and that's either extending like this or playing Kema like this. First we will take a look on A, because it's usually more simple and it appears in most of the professional games, and probably you have seen already this variation, which is a peaceful variation, which is a compromise. Black gets some influence on the left side, and White still keeps the corner. White doesn't have only option to play here. White can also extend like this. And if Black play and if Black plays Hane and White plays Hane, then Black can either think about tenuking, or extending like this. This result is actually almost the same as the basic Joseki result. However, there is a change that white actually builds more points by playing here. White's corner is definitely bigger. However, on the other hand, black's influence is also stronger because the pip is now on the sixth line at p14 and it cannot be so effectively used. So actually this result is is okay for both. Since we are taking look only on basic variations, this is probably all I can show from the extension at q15. There is actually one more which I could show, but it actually requires a ladder, and it's if white jumps here. But this actually reminds us something, because in case black plays here, then white will just take the punuki and we are back to the double hane joseki. As you will see actually quite a lot of times in this lecture, there are actually many variations which give the same result, but you will get there by a different order of moves. So it's very important to not only memorize the variations, but to know the meaning of each move. So that's why it's important to understand it. However, black has also some other options after this. Then of course black should try to cut from here. But as we have said, it requires a ladder for white when white jumps at r14, which means black cannot play here. If black could play here, then of course the result is amazing for black, because black gets a nice wall and walls of white's small corner inside. So black has to play here, which is a big difference, because white can run with the stone at r14, and there is a lot of agi. Black's shape is not really perfect, so black definitely doesn't want to choose this variation much. So black usually plays here first, and in case black plays here first, then white has some options what to do. For example, white can just connect like this, and it's again some kind of compromise that white gets the corner and black takes the wall. In case white plays here, this is actually very nice very nice variation where you can learn some nice tesuji and order of moves. So it's very important to realize on which side we should cut now. In case black cuts here, then black can actually get a very nice nose tesuji here. If black would just run like this, then of course black's crawling is not so amazing. So in most of the situations, the nose tesuji is definitely better move. If white goes back, then it's a bit slack. Then black gets quite a nice wall. So white should probably run out, white actually separated black's stones, and white is alive in the corner. Black can actually get a better result here, and it's very important to cut from this side. In case if white just takes the stone, then this actually is very similar to the result as in the double hane joseki, but black got this exchange, which is definitely a positive exchange, and this result slightly favors black. So white will not choose to take the stone this time, and white will connect. If black uses the nose tesuji, then if white separates the groups like before, then actually black has a nice continuation of descending here, and the white's corner is dead. So that's why it's very important to not give the punuki to white inside the corner. And if white tries to leave somehow, then we can just follow the proverb of there is a death in hane, and white is dead in the corner. So white probably has to play atari like this and then extend there, and this is again kind of a compromise. And it's definitely good to realize that either q12 and r11 then both of these places are definitely big continuations for white. Black can of course can also continue by extending here, but it doesn't have any other continuation for white next. So black usually doesn't play there right away in case it's not very variable. There is so as I have said, there are two options which come to mind in this position. The second one is this Hane. Kema. And in case white plays like this, then we get to the position which I have showed already, and we get this result. Still, there is this kind of peep, and white can of course later pretend to attack the wall, like I have showed in the basic variation, but it's not so easy anymore. Also, we can actually take a look what happens in the corner later. Black has quite some nice continuations, especially this cutting point. Because if white takes the stone like this, white gets squeezed and black takes these two stones, which doesn't have to be always a disaster for white, because white can still alive, like white can still live somehow, but it's actually an option for black how to make some troubles inside white's corner. In case white cannot play Q18, which is in most of the cases, white has to take the stone somehow to protect the corner. However, if white does it this way, then black has an option to start the call, either like this or like this, which can be again a severe problem for white. And if white wants to make his corner 100% alive, then white plays like this. Then now white has to connect like this, and black plays the hanging connection. And if white now tenukis, then this block is sent on white's group. Then white is just dead after this Hane. So this result can be quite painful for white. So actually, in most of the games of the professional players, still white usually takes and lets black to start the call, because in case white wins the call, white of course gets also some profit, because white can win the call like this. White doesn't have to only connect or take the stone. White can cut here, which is very very valuable. So black is also risking something in the call. So black has to find the right timing to cut at S17. There are also some other moves which black can choose, so we can take a look on them. First one is tenuki. And if black tenukis, white has some continuations in this corner. Like there is a peaceful one. White can either play like this, which is the strongest continuation how to protect all of the problems. And he now actually the roles a bit switch, because white now has a very big corner, and black's group can be hardly considered as a wall anymore. Now it's more like a group which can be very easily attacked now. But black tenukit there, so black has to count with such continuation. In case white would like to initiate a fight, white can also cut like this, and the fight will most likely continue some kind of way like this. So white secures the corner, and white separated black's groups, but still white has to also take care of himself in the center, so it looks like an even fight. Then we have options how to continue here. Black can think about this move, but just in some situations. Black can also consider this Hane, And there are very rare situations also, same like with A, that black can also think about this hanging connection. First, we can take a look on the simpler ones. If black plays this hub double Hane, that doesn't work directly. Black can maybe think about occupying the corner like this, but the giving the pawn key is too good. So black shouldn't think about this option in most of the cases. But in case black would like to develop the top side, then black can make this exchange and force white to take. And in case the right side is not interesting and the top side is very interesting, then this can be an option in some of the cases. But on an empty board, I wouldn't definitely recommend it. Also, the problem is that in case black would like to try play this Atari, then white will most likely not answer. If white answers, then of course it's a very nice exchange for black. But if white doesn't answer, then even next move white will most likely not answer, because there is still a call and black has to spend really a lot of moves to get some profit in the corner. White can also think about resisting playing here, and black can play the core, but black is also taking a risk here, because in case white gets this double pawn key, that white gets a very big local advantage. Black can think about this kind of hanging connection, and white will extend in case black wants to protect the cut at Q14, and also black wants to develop the top side. In that case, then definitely this move is possible, but it's quite rare to see it. Move which is definitely not rare is R18. This Hane actually is aiming at this double Hane, which has been seen in many AlphaGo games, and nowadays it's one of the most popular jokes, but it's not the only option what to do here. First of all, white can avoid all of these variations by playing like this. I have already showed this variation quite a few minutes ago, but in that case the situation was like this. Basically, black made this very nonsense exchange. And as I said, this result was good for white. However, if we put out this stone, then white is definitely not dead 100% alive. So most likely, if black now connects, white will just extend like this. This result is considered to be slightly better for black locally. But in some situations, if white wants to avoid all of the complicated variations, it's definitely an option. But in most of the cases, white harness here, and now black again has some choices what to do. First, we can take a look what happens if black plays this double Hane. As it's clear to see, black can now cut here in case white tries to capture the stone. So this is definitely not possible for white to play. So since white doesn't want to cut at R13 anymore, white cuts from here and takes the stone. In case white would immediately take the stone, black has an option to connect here. So this some of you who are studying with Lila Zero, in some older variations this joseki has been offered very often, but in nowadays it's very rare to see it. Most likely, even though black's shape doesn't look amazing, this exchange is just too bad for white. So black should be probably better in this case. Which means white should cut here and then try to destroy black's shape a bit. And after black plays Atari and white takes, black has several options. In case black has a ladder, then black can just capture the stone like this. If black doesn't have a ladder, then black has to think about some other connection, for example playing here or playing here. What is also good to remember, that in case white plays some ladder breaker, usually black covers like this. Black can of course directly take the stone. It has the advantage there are no cutting points around here, but it's definitely not that flexible as this kind of move. So this kind of move we have seen in the AlphaGo self-play games very often. But it's of course not the only protection what is possible to play. No, Black doesn't have to an only an option to play this Atari. Black can also capture the stone here, which White follows by taking this stone. Black plays here, White has to protect, and Black captures in the ladder. Of course, this variation is possible just in case the ladder works. If the ladder doesn't work, then playing here without a stone at P18 is not that good as before. What happens if White Ataris here? That's actually kind of a detail, which can somehow matter. At the first glance, it looks like the result is almost same as before, that just this exchange has been made. But this exchange can be actually quite useful for Black, because in case Black plays here later, White has the option to either tanuki or eventually even play like this. Because if we take a look to the future, then maybe these stones can be locally dead if White runs out with the stone at Q40. So this can be definitely an option for White. It's of course a detail, but it can matter. So in most of the cases, if Black captures here, White will capture the stone there. If we go back, then we can take a look on the other option what Black has here, which is a bit more entertaining, let's say. Then it's Black can play here. What is very good to remember, please don't cut here. I have already seen some Dan Players games where Black cut here and then White just takes and Black didn't get anything. So in this case, White will definitely not take and not allow Black the squeeze. White will just take and is definitely happy because White fixed basically all the problems in the corner. So this is the right cut. And White has two options how to answer. White can either just take the stone this way, but I believe that if Black connects like this, Black's shape outside is too strong. So I wouldn't recommend this, and definitely I would recommend to cut once. I have seen some professional games when Black tried to play this core, but for such a core you have to have very giant core threat. So in most of the cases this is not possible and Black simply connects. And White can actually already go out, because please mind that White is already alive in the corner. Because White can always live either by capturing this stone or capturing this stone. So White doesn't have to necessarily answer. So White can just go out or just simply tanuki. So this Joseki can be seen also very often in the professional games. After this, White has also another option how to play, and that's to capture this stone, which I have mentioned already, and White will allow this squeeze to Black. Probably the first move which comes to mind in this situation is to extend like this, which is capturing S14 stone, and at the same time it's somehow protecting Q14 cut. However, I have never seen this move in a professional game yet. And I believe the problem is that if White jumps out, then this peep is too annoying. Also, at the same time, White gets T17 in center, which means White is 100% alive. So that's most likely that's the case why you cannot see this move in a professional game. So in most of the cases, Black plays like this. White cuts, Black connects, and now White has two options. There is a peaceful option to play like this, and usually White doesn't choose this variation in case the ladder works for Black, because Black gets quite a nice shape and White doesn't have probably enough compensation. Also, White for sure has to answer. Personally, I don't have a problem to take white here, but as far as I know, most of the strong players don't like this result for white that much. But in case the red ladder is working for white, then black has to play like this. So black's shape is not that strong as before, but this is still a flexible move. However, since the ladder is working, then later black can only sacrifice like this in case white would like to attempt for the capture of the three stones, which white can do almost any time. But in most of the cases on an empty board, it's not so good result for white because the sacrifice of black is quite nice. White can of course still think about playing here, or this is actually also an option in case there are already strong black stones on somewhere in the top left corner, then this is already 100% alive group for white. White can also think about tanuki, but if white tanukis, black has some options how to attack white's group. This is a very often seen move. Or black can also, for example, attach here or play some pincer, and black wants to force white to play here in the end, which would be kind of a painful life. As I said, white usually doesn't choose O17 move in case the ladder is working for black. And then white has a fighting move to play like this. And in most of the cases, something like this happens, which means white gets a move at M17, black makes his group stronger by a move at R11, and there is still some fight going on in the center. Black has probably slight advantage in this fight, however, white naturally got the moves at the top, which means it should be quite a fair result. Also, white can think about sacrificing the three stones right now, because they are quite heavy, and in case there is not a clear profit white can get from them, white can just abandon them there. Because still black has to spend at least another move to capture them. So, let's go to the start. Facing this schema, there is not the only option of playing R15. White can also think about playing here. If we go back to like 10, maybe 15 years ago, we used to use this schema very often to take tanuki, to play tanuki after that. And white in most of the cases played here. And if black tanukied, then in most of the cases white usually continued like this. However, in these days we explored. Then actually in case black tanukis, then this cut is quite severe. This cut is quite severe, and black doesn't really have a great shape at the top, and the three stones on the right can be very severely attacked. There is actually not only this move, there is also this shoulder hit, or there is also this interesting nose tesuji, because in case black goes down, white can play here and black will probably have to crawl somehow and fight back. So black can get into some trouble. Also, what is actually good to mind in this case, that actually at the beginning of this lesson, we showed that this move is centered on white's corner. But that's not 100% true always, in case white has this hane in center. And this is definitely the case where black will answer on white's hane, and there is no option anymore how to kill the corner. In case white will just protect like this, and black will throw in here, then white will not take like this anymore and die. White will make life like this. And this is just a life in this case. So that's why white is definitely not afraid to cut around Q15. So the move at R14 is definitely not being used to play tanuki after that if white attaches like this, and black has some options what to do. Black can of course come back to this variation, but that's not so great as we have said. Black can just extend, which is possible, which is kind of same as white does this exchange. We can basically imagine it there. And that means that we also come back to the joseki which we have seen today. There is a very new variation of published in the recent versions of Lila Zero, and there's actually this variation which is very interesting, which is quite an interesting exchange, but there are also some many side variations, and maybe one of the sides can choose to tenuki, so it can become quite complicated. In case white blocks here, then we can actually again come back to something what we have seen today. This is very which is very familiar to us from today, and which we have reviewed. I have seen a game in on European Championship where white played here, and then just took a stone. I have doubts to believe that white this is acceptable for white, because this stone is just wasted. The most complicated stuff starts after black plays here. And now white can choose to either play Hane or cut here or cut here. All of the variations get very complicated, and it would probably take a lot of time to review it here, probably a few hours. This joseki is called the flying knife, and it's actually kind of Taisha or an avalanche of these days. Because there is a really lot of variations, complicated variations. Even the professional players don't know all the variations, definitely. And it's definitely possible to still explore more variations right now, which not even the AI programs know. So this is definitely not a good idea to review it here. If we come back to the beginning and this basic variation, there are actually still some continuations which we can consider. What we can definitely consider is this move, for example. This move is actually possible to play also in this situation, where we can just come back like this. This is kind of similar. And white has several options what to do after that, which are good to know. White can definitely come back to this joseki, which we have explored already. If white goes back like this, then black definitely gains something. So white usually doesn't go back like this. White can think about this Hane, and black has two options now. If the top side is interesting, black can think about playing like this. And what is definitely important to realize is actually this pip is not a good exchange for white. Usually pip is a good exchange, but not in this case, because black has an option to cut like this after the Hane. Okay, so since the pip is not there, black gets a very solid wall. Black can then think about cutting like this, and if white connects, and black gets the corner, it's also a possible variation for black. Because in this case, black didn't give either a ponuki or a hanging connection at S12, and even though white is already 100% alive, in case the top side is interesting again, black can also think about this variation. In most of the cases, white plays like this, and in this case, actually white is not afraid of this cut. In case this happens, then white will just take the stone, let black connect, and white goes out like this. Even though it looks like the two white stones are wasted, they are definitely not that wasted as they look like, because for black it's not really easy to capture them. If black plays somewhere around here, still white can play some annoying moves, like for example attaching here, and white can sacrifice the stones in a very nice way. If white is afraid that the two stones are too valuable, white can also think about just saving them like this. And black will play like this and get the wall, but black lost the corner and black finished in Gotte. So probably in most of the cases this is not a good result for black. White can, after white came up, black can also play this Hane, and we have already seen some continuations after this for many times today. And if white takes, it's actually a variation how to escape from all of these complicated variations again. Again, the stone at S14 looks quite wasted, but it's again not so easy to capture it. If black plays, for example, here, white, the stone is definitely still not dead, and if black plays here, white can still play some annoying moves like this. Definitely black's extension is too close to the wall. What is a big advantage of white? That white is 100% alive and cannot be killed, which is always good to, or which is always good to realize. And that's actually what I believe the humans didn't realize before the AI came. That actually everything what has two eyes has a big advantage. It cannot be influenced anyhow, and definitely we can actually think about, if we go to extreme, then we can think about that what doesn't have two eyes still can be eventually killed somehow, or at least attacked. So that's a very big change also in thinking about the 3-3 invasion. That being alive in the corner is simply variable. So I think, I hope that, I didn't forget anything, and we explored as many basic variations as I could find in this corner. And I would like to also apologize for some maybe unusual expressions, because since I'm not a native English speaker, maybe some of my descriptions can be inaccurate or weird. So I would like to apologize for that, and I hope I will get better in the future. Anyway, I hope you get some you got some new knowledge and inspiration from this lesson, and see you sometime on the next lecture. Bye-bye.